Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning on our National Flag Day. A special honor to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area or looking for a new church home, we invite you to come say God in your new church home. A couple of announcements concerning our worship. Since the color is green and I see some faces who were not at worship last week at this service, but so you will not be know of these changes. Since the color is green, we are only using the hymn of praise after the apostolic reading, but we're using the second hymn of praise on page 204, the one that we have not sung before until last week, the one that begins, "Come, let us join our cheerful songs." Last week, you all did a very good job doing it the first time. So that is one change in the liturgy. So the greeting then directly into that hymn of praise. Also, our hymns come from Worship His Majesty. We try to place them in the pews where we usually you sit. So please look in your pew for Worship His Majesty when it comes to singing the hymns. We still need the ELW for the liturgy, but the hymns will be in Worship His Majesty. So let us now turn to page 94 in the front of the ELW, our regular worship book, to the order of confession and forgiveness. And I invite those who do so without difficulty to please stay. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now turn to "Come, We That Love the Lord," hymn number 525, in the red worship.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is June the 14th, 2015, third Sunday after Pentecost. Our color is green, and this hymn is written by Isaac Watts, who's the father of English hymn writing. He complained to his father when he was only a teenager that he didn't like the hymns. They were dreary. And the father said, "Can you do any better?" And he began to write hymns. He wrote one a week for most of his life. And this is "Come We That Love the Lord." Isaac Watts, written in the early 1700s. He's written wonderful, wonderful hymns, Isaac Watts. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio.
Thank you.
O God, you are the tree of life, offering shelter to all the world. Graft us into yourself and nurture our growth, that we may bear your truth and love to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God's word.
Emily Widener is reading our scripture today. Emily Widener.
Our first reading this morning is from the book of Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will take a sprig from the lofty top of the cedar. I will set it out. I will break off a tender one from the topmost of its young twigs. I myself will plant it on a high and lofty mountain, on the mountain high.
Singing Psalm 92 responsibly. Our theme is to do with trees today.
For the love of Christ, earth. those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view, even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view. We know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Pastor John Pollock is now reading the gospel. We're singing the gospel acclamation. Special music by Becky Dimitroff. The theme today is God is the Tree of Life, offering shelter to everyone.
Thank you.
Saturday wanted to go back to work. So he shows up at a lumberjack business and he tells the foreman, I want to go back to cutting down trees. The foreman looked at him and said, I'm sorry, fella, but you're just too old. You can't be a lumberjack anymore. But the old lumberjack kept trying to convince him that he could do the job. And it got to the point where the foreman became irritated and said, look, buddy, he said, I've hired and fired all kinds of lumberjacks. He said, you are too weak, too feeble, too old to be able to even swing the axe. So you know you cannot have the job. To which the old lumberjack said, come on, let's go outside and I'll prove it to you. So the old lumberjack and the foreman went outside, and the lumberjack picked up a heavy axe and started cutting down a tree, cutting down a rugged tile. The foreman was amazed. He said, how'd you learn to cut trees down like that? I've never seen anything like that before in my life. And the old lumberjack said, would you remember have you ever heard of the Sahara Forest? And the foreman said, huh? What? You mean the Sahara Desert? And the old lumberjack said, oh yeah, that's what you call it today. The old lumberjack used his axe to cut down many a tree. Well, in the same way, the Word of God is the axe of our Lord that has cut down for centuries the trees of sin, the trees of the devil, the trees of disbelief, the trees of false doctrine, the trees of heresy. And it is through that power of the Word of God that Jesus is speaking it out this morning in our gospel lesson. As the fourth chapter of Mark begins, Jesus is in a teaching situation and he is teaching parables. The very first parable that opens up the fourth chapter of Mark is a famous, more detailed parable about sowing, where he talks about the sower went out to sow and some of the seed fell on rocky ground and some fell among thorns and some fell in good soil, and talks about what happens to each seed where it was planted, how they sprout in the rocky soil. They don't take much root, so they burn up quick when any problems come along. And then the thorn, the represent those who hear the word and let the world choke out their faith. And then those in good soil, of course, those who hear the word and become followers of Jesus Christ. Well, as we began our reading, this was the second parable using the idea of sowing and seed. And this one, we see three things that illustrate the power of the Word of God. Three things that the church needs to remember and needs to recapture about the power of God. And the first thing we learn, as Jesus tells in parables today in our gospel lesson, is that God's Word is powerful enough to change human hearts. The first parable, he talks about how that little seed goes into the ground and the farmer sleeps and wakes up day and night pass. Suddenly that seed sprouts into a stalk and then the stalk into a head and then a head into the full grain of wheat. It's harvest time, he takes a sickle and harvests, but he has no idea how that little seed went from that seed to be that grain of wheat. Well, scientists today still could not tell us exactly how the germination process takes place. How you take that corn, a kernel of corn, and you take that wheat seed or barley or a geranium seed or a tree seed or whatever kind of seed, you plant it in the ground, and suddenly there comes up through the ground that sprouts a stalk, and then that stalk grows into whatever it is, a flower, corn, plant, wheat, grain, tree, whatever. Well, what this is demonstrating is the seed is the Word of God, and the changing of it is how the power of God can enable the planting of the seed of His Word to change a person. The Word of God has the power to change people. We see it happen as we read the history of the church. When Jesus is crucified, all we know about are the disciples and a few women and a few secret followers in the Sanhedrin, Joseph. Arimathea, Nicodemus. We know of nobody else. Then Jesus is resurrected, and he starts appearing to believers. Now, St. Paul goes on and tells us later on in his first letter to the Corinthians that there were actually 500 believers by the time of Jesus' resurrection, and then he appeared to all of them. And then, as St. Paul says, as the least, then he also appeared unto me. But you think about it, a group of 500 facing the power of the Roman Empire, the greatest empire there ever was. An empire that should have been able to crush out that movement completely in just a matter of days. And yet through the power of the Word of God, through the power of sharing the word of Jesus Christ with the Roman Empire, the church continued to grow bigger and bigger and bigger until it had spread throughout the Roman Empire. And from Britain to the Caucasus to the borders of Iran and Iraq, throughout the Mediterranean world, North Africa, basically all the world that was known at that time. And the church spread not with an army, not with fire and sword, telling people convert or die. It did not grow by telling people either you believe or you're an infidel and we will kill you. The church grew by people sharing the powerful word of our Lord Jesus Christ, that God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And God sent his son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. See that power of the Word of God. By the 4th century, Christianity had conquered Rome. The Roman Empire didn't conquer Christ. And that Word still has that same power today. That Word of our Lord Jesus Christ can still come to someone and enter into their heart and change them. It can cause the heroin addict to put down their needle, the crack addict to put down their crack pipe, the drunk to put down their bottle, the abuser to stop abusing. It can make a radical change in anyone who hears that good news. But we must use that good news. We must share that good news. We must proclaim that good news. We cannot substitute the Word of God with something else. It just doesn't work. You cannot substitute the Word of God with something more hip, something more modern, something more cool. You preach Jesus Christ crucified. The power of that message will enter people's hearts and change their lives. In the days of the great evangelist C.H. Spurgeon, a new auditorium was built in London called the Crystal Palace. And the builders of that auditorium asked C.H. Spurgeon if he would come in and speak, say some words so they could check out the acoustics. So early one morning, C.H. Spurgeon and a couple of his deacons from his church went to the Crystal Palace, and he got up on the platform, on the stage, and his deacons went to the back of the auditorium in different places to see if he could be heard. And all C.H. Spurgeon said was, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." That C.H. Spurgeon and the deacons left. Well, many years later, C.H. Spurgeon's brother was sent to a man who was dying in a little town outside of London. And when Spurgeon's brother went in to see this fellow, he said, "I was a painter by trade." He said, "I was an irreligious fellow." He said, "I never thought much about my soul or about eternal life or about what happened in death. I was just busy painting and doing my thing." He said, "But one day early in the morning, I was in the ceiling of the Crystal Palace painting that ceiling. And suddenly out of nowhere, I heard this voice say, 'Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.'" And he said, "Those words came into my heart like a knife." And he said, "From that day, I accepted Jesus' invitation of grace, his invitation of mercy. And he became Lord of my life, and I've spent the last years of my life trying to serve him and do his will." Well, I since found out that it was your brother who said those words. And I would ask that if you, that after you leave here, you would go back to your brother and tell him that he is the one that led me to the door of salvation into the kingdom of heaven. See, that is the power of the word of our Lord Jesus Christ. That is why it must be proclaimed. That is why it cannot be replaced. I've told you oftentimes that how when I was in seminary, there suddenly began this attitude in Lutheran churches of doing away with the sermon. Or instead of doing a sermon, doing a little five-minute cutesy pie thing. And the emphasis on preaching was kind of pushed to the side. But what have been the results of that? We've seen the result. As every year the ELCA reports another decline in membership. Without the Word of God, the church cannot grow. Without the proclamation that God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, the church cannot grow. Without the proclamation of God sent His Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through Him, the church cannot grow. And so Jesus uses this parable of a seed sprouting into grain to demonstrate the power of the Word of God. The power of the Word of our Lord Jesus Christ. The second lesson we learn is that the Word of God is so powerful, it can create a vast kingdom. Here he uses the imagery of the mustard seed. The smallest seed, you plant it in the ground and it turns into a 10 to 15 foot bush, which is so big the birds can nest in its branches. And the birds can find shelter there in a storm. Jesus' kingdom started out very small. The disciples, the women, some other followers, as St. Paul says, 500 most. But then we had that first Pentecost. And as St. Peter preached, when he was done, the crowd said, what must we do? He said, repent and be baptized and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. 3,000 were baptized that first Pentecost day. And then St. Luke tells us later on in that second chapter of Acts that the church continued to add new members each day, even members of the priests and Levites who were guardians of the temple, all through the proclamation of the good news of the gospel. Power of God went from a few stragglers in the Roman province of Judea becoming the greatest group in the world. And it can still grow today with the power of God's word. The church is exploding in Africa. The church is exploding in Asia. The church is exploding in Latin and South America. Caribbean or Caribbean, whatever it's properly said, in the Pacific. And there are those denominations that continue to explode and grow here in America and in Europe. But the only way it grows is through using the power of the Word of God. Simple people inviting others to come and see. Simple people inviting others to come and feel the love of God. A love of God that puts no restrictions, no barriers, no demands before you come to Him. You join an organization, you join a group, there's certain things you have to meet before you're allowed to join. You go through a probation period before you're made a member. It's not like that with God and His Son, Jesus Christ. No matter how deep in the gutter you might be, no matter how big of a sinner you might be, you believe in God's Son, Jesus Christ, and immediately you're welcomed into the kingdom of God. Immediately you're welcomed as a brother, a sister, in Jesus Christ. So the power of God's word still continues to make a vast kingdom. But it can only do so if it is used by those who are his followers. For the word of God is powerful enough in the hands of those who use it to make the kingdom grow. That's the last part of our gospel when he talks about it. He spoke in parables, and they heard him, and he didn't speak to them except in parables, but explained everything in private to his disciples. He explained it to his disciples so his disciples could take his words and then share it with others. Remember after Jesus' resurrection? Remember how we read about suddenly the disciples remember what Jesus had said? Or the two fellows on the road to Emmaus, how suddenly after Jesus had talked to them and then they sat down and they recognized Jesus when he broke and blessed the bread. They said, oh, how our hearts burned as he was unfolding the scriptures to us. And now we remember all those things he said when he was among us. The disciples took those words and spread it throughout the Roman Empire, laying the foundation for the worldwide church of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we must use that word of God and share it with others. We must let others know that God loves them. They love the word so much. Friday night, after a wedding rehearsal, I was going home and I went up Yellow Spring Street. At the corner of Pleasant Yellow Spring Street, there was some church there, I forget which church it was, that had a group of their members there on the corner in that vacant lot there, right across from the filling station in Pleasant Yellow Spring Street. And the preacher was preaching, and I went by the hair, loving up here, and said, God loves you no matter whether you're a man or woman, red, yellow, black, white, whatever, no matter your gender, whatever, God loves you. And that's the message. And that's the message that you have to share with others, so that they will come into the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. The church grew because individuals were so filled with joy over God's great gift that they couldn't keep from sharing it with those who had not heard it yet. They were so filled with joy that now they were assured of salvation, that they were assured of the forgiveness of sin, that they couldn't keep it to themselves. They had to invite their family members who were not yet Christian. They had to invite the merchants they did business with who were not Christian yet. They had to invite their neighbors who were not Christian yet, so that they could hear that good news that there is forgiveness and everlasting life through faith in the death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ. That is the power of God's word. Power to change people, the power to create a vast kingdom, the power that every Christian can use and shed to the non-believer. The highway to heaven is straight and simple. It's the easiest highway you'll ever go on. All it requires is to believe that Jesus Christ died for your sins upon the cross. That though your sins be like scarlet, by believing in Jesus, they're washed in the blood of the Lamb, and you are now as white as freshly fallen snow. All you have to believe is that on that third day he rose again. And all you have to do is believe that 40 days later he ascended into heaven, where he waits to come again to judge the living and the dead. That's it. Compare that to when you want to go on a trip. Well, you plan, you make your plans, you see the highways you're going to go on, you get going, suddenly you run into road construction. Then you run into a detour. And if you're somewhere where you don't know where you are, you get lost on the detour and you get further lost. Now, normally, to go from here to see my mom at Louisville is a 2-hour, 45-minute trip. But it never fails. Get north of Cincinnati, or in Cincinnati, and there are orange barrels everywhere. You're changing lanes down the one lane. You're stopped like a parking lot. Then you cross the bridge and get over to Kentucky, and somewhere on 71 or 75, there's orange barrels. And that 2-hour, 45-minute trip suddenly takes 3 hours. 15 minutes, or 3 hours and a half. Katie, Jackie, and Ben up in the river. Because in Indiana, they have two seasons. Winter and road construction. It doesn't matter if you're 70 or 65, you are going to run in the orange barrels somewhere on 70 or 65. It's guaranteed. And so the trip, a 5-hour trip, 4.5-hour trip, takes 6 hours. So by the time you've fought all that traffic, been in all that stop and go, it's like you're beating warning. But the highway to hell, no detours, no potholes, no traffic bumper to bumper, no accidents. The highway to heaven, simply the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, leading them what he did, makes salvation possible. That is the power of the Word of God. It is the power the church has to recapture. It is the power the church has to re-proclaim. It does no good to say, I think. It doesn't do any good to say, well, I feel. What does the church good is, thus says the Lord. Whoever believes and is baptized shall be saved. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. That whoever believes that God sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but to save the world, has his trip to heaven. So let us reemphasize the word of our Lord. Let us reemphasize that word, because that word cuts down sin, the devil, disbelief, and opposition, just like the lumberjack's axe chops down trees. And we are even more effective because the word of God is perfect. The word of our Lord Jesus Christ is perfect. The axe can become dull. The axe can get a chip in it. The axe can break. But not the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. One person said, the word of God is like a highway sign. You can ignore it if you don't care what happens. Most people on the highway care what happens, so they abide by the signs. The word of our Lord Jesus Christ, faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, is that ticket to heaven. And it is a ticket that is to be shared with every person, no matter who or where they are. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. We will now sing Sweet Hour of Prayer, hymn number 408, in the worship of His Majesty.
This hymn is attributed to William Walford. It was brought to the United States by Thomas Salmon, and he states that William Walford was a blind minister, and he had heard him sing this song in England, and he published it in the New York Magazine in 1845. Looking now at the stained glass window, Jesus is speaking to the woman at the well, the first evangelist, the first person that he told that he was the Messiah. Join us in singing Sweet Hour of Prayer. This is attributed to William Walford, a blind minister from England. Thomas Salmon published it in a magazine in 1845 in the United States. Sweet Hour of Prayer.
Thank you.
Please turn to page 105 on the front of the ELW. And by those who came with that difficulty, please stay. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Ben and Carol Glaze are our ushers today, and they will be taking up the offering and walking down to the front of the church. This is the 14th of June, third Sunday, Pentecost. This is a green Sunday. The pastor is wearing green. The altar cloth is also green. We welcome you to come to St. John's Church anytime. Flowers today are in loving memory of the sister of Joanne Myers Craig, from her brother and sisters and their families, in her memory. And the additional flowers today are from the April Petrie wedding. We welcome you anytime to come to our church. We have services at 8 o'clock at the drive-in, at Melody Christian drive-in, and 10:30. This is the service you're watching right now on YouTube. We welcome you to come. We love you. We need you. We'd love to see you here worshiping with us, worshiping our Lord Jesus Christ, God's Son, Holy Spirit. The theme today is that God is the tree of life, sheltering all of us. Many of the scriptures have to do with trees. Today we have the service of the Word. We don't have Holy Communion. Holy Communion is the first and third Sundays and festivals, and also on Wednesday evening. We invite you to come on Wednesday evening at 6:30. We can receive communion every week. Vacation Bible School is June the 22nd through the 24th, 9 a.m. to noon. It's be held at Good Shepherd Lutheran Church, grades pre-K through 5th grade, 9 a.m. to noon. So just come on June the 22nd, Bible School, 22nd through the 24th. We've worshiped today. We've confessed our sins. We've repented. We believe. We love God, we love our neighbor. We are looking forward to spending eternity together.
Let us pray. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray for the growth and life of the church, that you may scatter lavishly the seed of the gospel of Christ, that his promises bear the fruit of faith in us, and that we walk not in the counsel of the wicked, but delight in the law of the Lord. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who live in unbelief, that they may be led to repentance and faith in Jesus Christ, to take refuge in the branches of Christ's church, and to grow in the knowledge that the Savior died and was raised for them. Lord, in your mercy. We ask that you would strengthen our lives in Christ, that we may walk by faith and not by sight, that we constantly anticipate being at home with our Lord, and that we rejoice that Christ died for all, so that we who live might no longer live for ourselves, but for him who for our sake died and was raised. Lord, in your mercy. O Creator of the universe, we pray that you would provide favorable weather for the fruits of the earth, that you would care for those who raise our food, that you would supply an abundant harvest that we willingly share with those in need. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Compassionate Father, we pray for those who are grieving, sick, or suffering. that the Holy Spirit grant them faith that trusts that even when this tent in which we are clothed is destroyed, you have waiting for us an eternal home not made with hands, and that until what is mortal is swallowed up by life, grant us help and healing from our Lord Jesus Christ, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for faith that endures to the end, that our Heavenly Father receive our thanks for all the saints who have gone before us, and that the seed of his gospel sprout and grow in our lives until the final harvest. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
In your hands, O Lord, we commend all for him we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with When the Roll is Called the Younger, in number 692. And those who can do so without difficulty,
this hymn was written by James Black, a minister, Methodist minister from Williamsport, Pennsylvania. Wrote it in 1896. He was calling the roll at his youth group. One of the girls was missing, and this inspired him to sing, to do this song. The daughter who was missing was daughter of an alcoholic, and he missed her and wrote this song. And was inspired to write it down. When the roll is called up yonder, Methodist minister from Williamsport, Pennsylvania. YouTube. Tune in anytime. We're happy to bring you this service. Our church offers Christian school program 3-4, nursery and pre-K. They're taking registration now for the preschool, so call the office. The school office is 325-4311. Tune in anytime. We thank you for joining our worship service this Lord's Day. We hope and we pray that God will continue to bless you, and we pray for you, pray you continue to pray for us and our YouTube ministry. If you know how to do this on YouTube, we invite you to take your computer or your iPad to one of the shut-ins and show the service to them. You can tune it in at any time. Just click on to Google, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio.